respected Guruji, Mohan Bhagavat, and the respected men on the dais, all respected members of the audience. I was wobbling in my mind as to whether I should speak in the language in which the proceedings have been conducted thus far, or in a language by which my speech would be understood by our Honorable Guruji. I have chosen the latter because if I speak in English in an audience in a state of Kerala where the literacy rate is so high, it would be easy for the audience also to follow and for our honorable guest Guruji can also follow. I deem it as a real honor and a privilege that I am invited to preside over this very highly venerated function, Guru Pooja. You know from my name that I am a Christian. I was born in that. I practice in that religion. I am a church-going Christian. But my advantage is that I have also learned many things about the Rashtriya Swayam Sevak Sangh. I developed an admiration towards this disciplined core of this country as early as 1979. When I was posted as additional district judge of Calicut, the principal district judge was Mr. A.R. Srinivasan. Anyone who knew him will agree that his honesty is 100%, his integrity is transparent, his scholarship is unparalleled, and his commitment to the country is unquestioned. Above all, the disciplined life he followed was also very admirable. On his retirement, I took over as the principal district judge, but immediately Mr. A.R. Srinivasan became a member of the Rashtriya Swayam Sevak Sangh. We together used to communicate and converse many things. That occasion gave me the advantage of jettisoning many things which the smearing and simmering propaganda made by interested persons outside about Rashtriya Swayam Sevak Sangh could be eliminated in my mind. I became a real admirer of this organization. I regard many things on the objectivity point of view. Otherwise, it is not a prejudice, it is a weakness of human being, because a human being is not prepared to believe a thing without objectivity. When objectivity has been applied, the smearing propaganda earlier that RSS is responsible for the murder of Mahatma Gandhi appeared to me to be unjust and uncharitable. I learned more about it. Of course, the mere fact that the assassin happened to be once upon a time a member of that organization cannot make a disciplined organization responsible for the murder of the father of the nation. Had it been so, can you say that the entire Sikh community of India is responsible for the murder of Indira Gandhi? Can it be said that merely because Jesus Christ was crucified by Roman soldier on the orders of a Roman judge, that the whole people of Rome at that time have committed the murder of Jesus Christ? There should be an objectivity in approaching these things. I therefore went and read the judgment of Justice Cosley in Mahatma Gandhi assassination case, and I found that learned judge of Punjab High Court had completely exonerated Rashtriya Swayam Sevak Sangh as having anything to do with the assassination of Mahatma Gandhi. I say that this smearing campaign must end in this country. Otherwise, it will be really unjust on the part of anyone. With this approach, I had seen this organization from a distance. I happened to travel with the predecessor of our honorable guest today. Mr. Sudarshanji was with me in the train from Chennai up to my hometown station. We could communicate many things during that time. It was amazing to learn his great scholarship and how he insisted on a simple living. And I found out that this is a hallmark for the members of this organization: simple living and high thinking. And thereafter, I want to tell you that every Christmas he used to send me a Christmas greeting card which contained the quotation from a gospel of the Bible and a precept from Bhagavad Gita. I used to reciprocate in the same way as he did. And for me, that gave me an opportunity of learning more and more about this organization. And the best test I had in my life about this organization is during the dark months of emergency when Indira Gandhi declared the constitution suspended on the major portion. When the whole country became benumbed before the whip swished by Mrs. Indira Gandhi, the only non-political organization which worked fearlessly in the subterranean sector was the Rashtriya Swayam Sevak Sangh. With the result that this great country, Bharat, could get completely liberated from the pangs of a dictatorship. We owe very much to this organization for sacrificing many lives and many of the pleasures in life for the purpose of regaining what our leaders have gained for this country, namely the fundamental rights of this country. Now I am disturbed in seeing that for the sake of vote banks, the security of the nation is compromised in many regards. Article 19 of the Constitution is a catalogue of freedoms for the Indian people. But every such freedom is restricted to one thing, that is a reasonable restriction to. A common thing is the security of the state. The constitution makers were very insistent that the primordiality should be given to the security of the state because we have to live in this state. When I come across many instances of official activities, governmental and political, where security of the state is given less prominence than the vote bank, I am really disturbed. That is a matter on which the country should stand unanimously and uniformly and with strident voice declare that we will not tolerate such a policy to be followed. The propaganda that Rashtriya Swayam Sevak Sangh is anti-minority is a baseless propaganda. After all, what is a minority? I have realized that according to the Rashtriya Swayam Sevak Sangh, whatever religion you belong to, you must be a full patriot. Your faith is immaterial. Whichever faith you follow, only insistence for them is that you shall not have extraterritorial loyalties. I also realize that no one is entitled to tell somebody else that my religion is better than your religion and therefore abandon your religion and join my religion. No person who has any knowledge of the fundamental of his own religion cannot say that. The basic precept of one's own religion is that the other religion is not only equally important, but multiplicity of religions sometimes is a gift of God to mankind, because all religions have got weaknesses. And in order to replenish the weakness of one religion, some benefits are given to another religion. It is a country where a composite culture has been created, where faith is immaterial, but your loyalty, your commitment, and your patriotism should be given the most important thing. I have a different concept about minority. I used to speak out this aspect on many platforms, for which I have received more brickbats than flowers. Who is a minority in the country? Only that section which has got minus features. Minority is discernible from Article 29 of the Constitution, where any section of India can be a minority. It can be based on culture, script, language. Any section which is suffering from any disadvantage could be a minority, provided they are numerically less. Faith-wise, minority is recognized in Article 30 only for one limited purpose, that is for conducting educational institutions without the steamroller majority rolling over that. If a person is able to read Article 29 first, as a student of Constitution, I'll tell you, it does not envisage a minority based on religion or faith. Comes to Article 30, this word religion is mentioned only with regard to the educational institutions. I was a member of the 11 judges bench in the Supreme Court first, which could not complete the argument in TMA Pai case. The point of view which emerged among the majority of judges at that time was that the education envisaged in Article 30 should only be secular education and not professional education. When we put it to Mr. Pali S. Nariman, the great lawyer became angry and he said that is an aspect which has been concluded long, long ago, that the word education will cover anything even beyond, much beyond secular education. Unfortunately, our bench could not complete the hearings and arguments could not, and the judgment could not be delivered. Many years later, after my retirement, another bench was formed with 11 judges. And there also, Mr. Fallius Nariman addressed arguments. And finally, the verdict came accepting that education in Article 30 means education at any level. I am mentioning this for another purpose. That great lawyer, who is really the author of this concept of the plenary meaning for education, has written an autobiography wherein he confessed that today I intensely regret having adopted that attitude towards education. The whole disasters in this country in the education field on account of pioneering that aspect in the country which Supreme Court accepted, unfortunately. I want to mention this at some august place. I have chosen this assembly for bringing to them their notice that education in Article 30, even according to the great lawyer who pioneered this argument, is that it should be limited only to the secular education. So that is the only area where religion has got something to say about minority. Otherwise, in a big country like India, minority should have nothing to do with faith. Faith could be changed by anyone. That is exactly what happened. When a medical college was started by Palaniappa Gowndan in Tamil Nadu, later he found that because of some new legislations he will get much benefit. He converted into Christianity and became Deva Sahayam and is continuing that medical college now. Anyone can change it like that for the purpose of, if you are making a law in order, based on a faith, in a secular nation, in a secular republic like ours, that shall not happen. In a secular republic, religion shall not be your identity, but your being an Indian shall be your identity. That is what precisely Zakir Hussain, when he became the Rashtrapati of India, said. He was congratulated by T.V.R. Shenoy, the journalist. Zakir Hussain is a great scholar, was a vice chancellor. When T.V.R. Shenoy approached him and told him, Rashtrapati ji, I congratulate you because it is a great victory of secularism in India. Zakir Hussain asked him, in what way it is a great victory of secularism? Then he said, that a Muslim became a president of India is a great victory of secularism. Zakir Hussain looked at him and smiled. T.V.R. Shenoy asked him, why Rashtrapati you are smiling at me? He answered, Shenoy, I smiled hearing your notion of secularism. Secularism will be, he said, next sentence, secularism will be achieved in India only the day when you do not know my religion. My dear friends, take it from me. Secularism has nothing to do with religion in this country. You should not know my religion in the same way as I shall not be bothered about your religion. That is your faith. In whatever way you acquire it or you develop it, it is your private matter. This is something I learned very much during my travel with Sudarshan ji from Chennai to Kottayam. He insisted on that. He told me, sir, you can be a pious Christian. I asked him, in what way you know that I am a pious Christian? That is a different matter, he said. But we are only insisting, whatever be your faith, your primary commitment must be to this nation, to this country. On that matter, I very much admire. I am a great admirer of this organization, the discipline exhibited everywhere, and Even today, the manner in which the flowers have been offered before the Dhwaj gave me the real impression that discipline is given real impetus to your working and performances. Discipline is needed for a nation, and discipline is a fundamental thing for the growth of a nation. Whichever nation has progressed outside, you can see that where discipline has been inculcated in the citizens. I think on that matter, Rashtriya Swayamsevak Sangh is a model to me also. Thank you very much.